Good morning. Welcome to Willow Hill this morning. Our watchword from the week comes from Isaiah chapter 25, verse number 1, which says, O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Isaiah 25, 1. Very thankful to have each and every one of you here this morning. And it is always a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. It's a blessing to have those who may be watching online, and very thankful to have be able to do that and be able to share in that way. So as we do that, as we get started this morning, most of your announcements are on the back. I won't go over all of them. I will say choir practice right after worship this morning, handbell practice at 4 o'clock. Craft workshops for the bazaar at 7 o'clock on Thursdays, and the bazaar is coming up quicker than you'd think. It's about 4 weeks away, I think it is. So it is coming around, and there is Dewey Bakery order forms that are available. If you would like to buy tickets for the quilt that Johanna is making, see me after the service, because I actually took the tickets home to take them to work to sell and forgot to bring them back this morning. So I will write it down and get everything back to you. So, do what? Okay, and Adam has another roll of tickets downstairs, so we can do it that way too. I forgot there was an extra roll of tickets. So, but either way you want to do it, it's fine with me. Just wanted to make sure everybody knew, because like I say, I took them to work and sold some of them, and I be honest with you, I was chasing a dog this morning till Amy backed out of the garage, and had to get my stuff. She said, it's time to go, we're going to be late. but anyway, and don't forget our trunk or treat on Sunday, October the 29th from 5 until, and we will be having chicken stew that night. And having a good time. So decorate your trunk, bring some candy, give out to the kids, and let's just have a good time with fellowship and everybody that comes. So very thankful to have each and every one of you again. If you would, this morning, if you would, in your Moravian hymnal, turn to the liturgy on page 18 in the front of your Moravian hymnal, and let's stand together. And I'll give you just a second to get there. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
O Lord, open thou our eyes. To thee, Lord God, our Father.
Mercies, and God of all comfort.
Thou hast chosen us in Jesus Christ, our Lord, before the foundation of the world.
Thou hast delivered us from the power of darkness, and hast translated us into the kingdom of thy dear Son.
Thou hast blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Behold, what manner of love, O Father, thou hast bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God.
Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name.
You can be seated. Unto thee, O Christ, thou Son of the living God. Jesus Christ is the eternal Word, who was made flesh and dwelt among us. In him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. He is the true God and eternal life.
He reconciled all things unto God, whether things on earth or things in heaven.
And has made peace through the blood of his cross.
Thank you.
to Thee, O Holy Spirit, our teacher, guide, and comforter.
Our lips shall praise Thee, and our lips shall declare Thy glory.
Thou dost shed abroad the love of God in the hearts of all believers, and dost make their bodies Thy holy temple. Thou dost sanctify us in the true faith and dost enable us to abide in Jesus Christ.
We now praise together with the Father and with the Son, now and into all eternity.
Maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten of Son of the God, begotten His Father for all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down
from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitted on the right hand. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father, who with the Father and His Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, and I believe in one
And you can be seated. I told you to look around at your neighbor and tell them you love them. Glad to worship with them this morning. But if you will, we will ask a couple of ushers to come. We'll take up our Sunday morning tithes and offerings and be blessed by the choir this morning. God, we thank you so much for allowing us this blessing, this time to be together, to grow together, to build bonds of love as a family. We thank you, God, for the Spirit which guides us, for your Son who gave his life for us, and for the grace you allow us to live in. May we be ever a blessing to thee and to thy kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Look at the world, everything all around.
seated. If you will turn in your favorite hymns of praise to hymn number 384, you can remain seated as we sing, "Does Jesus Care?"
Thank you.
Do you know He cares this morning? He cares for you. He cares for me. He loves His children. This morning, if you would, if you will turn to Psalm chapter 6, or Psalm 6, it ain't necessarily a chapter, but this is a Psalm of David. And if you'll put your finger there and then go to the 23rd Psalm. And while you're doing that, I will ask, a couple of weeks ago, I read a part of a sermon from S.M. Lockridge, and it was from the 1970s, and it was called, "That's My King." Did anybody go home and YouTube that, look it up on YouTube? It don't matter, you didn't have to, it is something that, it touches my heart, and I still had it in my Bible, so I'm going to read it one more time because I think it goes through with, or goes into what we have today and what we're going through today. Folks, we just sung a song that I know He cares. I know He cares. You know how I know He cares? It ain't because I just sung a song about how that I know He cares. It's because of what He gave. He gave His Son. His Son gave everything that He had. His Son, while hanging on a cross and at the end of His life, He was saying, "Father, forgive them." While on a cross, His Son looked at the thief that said to Him, "Remember me when you enter your kingdom." And Jesus Himself looked at this thief, or I'm assuming that He looked at the thief. I don't know that. It doesn't say that He looked at him, but He did tell him, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." We serve a God that is so much bigger, so much more powerful than we give Him credit for being. We live in a world that thinks that nuclear warheads are powerful. They are. But I serve a God that's bigger than any nuclear warhead that's ever been. I serve a God that we have sang over the years about, that He's got the whole world in His hand. He's so much bigger than everything that's going on in this walk of life. And He tells us, don't be worried, don't be concerned about those things because I am with you. He said, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the uttermost parts of the earth." Hallelujah, that's the God that I serve. That's the God that I serve. And when I hear S.M. Lockridge read or say or preach, "That's My King" from the 70s, it gets me excited. It gets me excited in the fact of that king that he was so excited about. And this preacher was excited when he was talking about it. He didn't read it like I did a couple of weeks ago, and he didn't read it like I will today, because it was his message. He knew what he was doing. But when he says, "That's my king," this is part of his sermon. He said, the Bible says, He is the King of the Jews. He is the King of Israel. He is the King of righteousness. He is the King of the ages. He is the King of heaven. He is the King of glory. He is the King of kings, and He is the Lord of lords. Now that's my king. David says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows us His handiwork. No means of measure can define His limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of His shoreless supply. No barriers can hinder Him from pouring out His blessing. He is enduringly strong. He is entirely sincere. He is eternally steadfast. He is immortally graceful. He is imperially powerful. He is impartially merciful. That's my King. He is God's Son. He is the sinner's Savior. He is the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone in Himself. He is unique. He is unparalleled. He is unprecedented. He's supreme." Hallelujah. He is supreme. He is preeminent. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the supreme problem in the higher criticism. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He is the cardinal necessity of spiritual religion. Now that's my king. He is the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good that you choose to call him. He's the only one able to supply all of our needs simultaneously. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defeats the feeble. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? That's my king. Do you know him? My king is the key of knowledge. He is the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He is the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of peace. The King of Kings, and he is the Lord of Lords. That's my king. Do you know him? His office is manifold. His promise is sure. His life is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy, and his burden is light. Oh, I wish I could describe him to you, but he is indescribable, he is incomprehensible, he is invincible, he is irresistible, and I'm trying to tell you that the heaven of heavens cannot contain him, let alone any man explain him. You can't get him out of your mind, and you can't get him off your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him. When they found out, they couldn't stop him. Pilate could not find no fault in him. The witnesses could not get their testimonies to agree, and Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my king. He always has been. He always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him, and he will not resign. That's my king. Praise the Lord. That's my king. This is the kingdom. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. And the glory is all his. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever. And when you get through with all the forevers, then amen. I read that this morning because I will tell you, I am not afraid of what's going on, but I do see some writing on the wall. I do understand that we're living in a time that is very uncertain, and I want us to understand that this morning we need to know who our King is. Without a shadow of a doubt, without any hint of hesitation, we need to know who our king is. David was a man after God's own heart, right? The Bible tells us that David was a man after God's own heart. And in Psalm chapter 6, we see David praying to a God in heaven that says in verse number 1, O Lord, rebuke me not in thine anger, neither chasten me in thy hot displeasure. Have mercy upon me, O Lord, for I am weak. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are vexed, my soul also sore vexed. But thou, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, deliver my soul. O save me for thy mercy's sake. For in death there is no remembrance of thee. In the grave, who shall give thee thanks? I am weary with my groaning all the night. Make I my bed to swim. I water my couch with my tears. Mine eye is consumed because of my grief. It waxeth old because of all of mine enemies. Depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity. For the Lord hath heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord hath heard my supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. Let all of mine enemies be ashamed and sore vexed. Let them return and be ashamed suddenly. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful for your word today. And God, as we break this bread of life, God, may you share with us as only your Holy Spirit can. May you help us in this time of need. This world is not our home. But God, we are living in concerning times. Not afraid of what this world has to offer. But Heavenly Father, afraid that some people is running out of opportunity to come to you. So help us to preach with haste and rightly divide the truth in Jesus' name. We give you grace, honor, or praise, honor, and glory. Amen. David here is a man after God's own heart, and he is crying out. And notice what he is doing. One of the things that we have said over time, if you read in Romans chapter number 10, verses 9 and 10, he is doing that very thing that he is confessing with his mouth to a God that loves him. He is confessing those things. Listen to him at the very beginning in verse number 1. He says, "Rebuke me not in thy anger, neither chasten me in thy hot displeasure. Have mercy upon me, for I am weak. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are vexed, my soul sore and vexed. But thou, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, deliver my soul, and save me for the mercy's sake, for thy mercy's sake." He's asking God, he said, save me from all this stuff. Save me from everything that is going on, everything that is happening. Save me. I need salvation. This is a man that was chosen by God to be anointed by Samuel. Samuel, right? As soon as I said it, I thought, is that right? But anointed by Samuel and was told, you're chosen by God to be king. Was given this right and this authority. This man who, if he lived today, would have, well, I don't know that he would have, but if he lived in today's society says, well, God called you. God called you. So that's time to puff up your chest, look down at people and say, yep, he called me. He didn't call you. But I want you to know something. God called each and every one of you. If you are a believer in him, he chose you. He chose you before you had the opportunity to choose him. Now, why do you say that, preacher? He says, because the Bible tells us that no man cometh unless the Father draw him. No man cometh unless the Father draw him. So you were chosen first. You were chosen. You are special enough. God loved you enough that he sent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to die on your behalf so that he could come to you and knock on your heart's door, that he could choose you, that you could repent of your sins, that you could confess of your unrighteousness and believe in your heart to a righteous God, one who is justified in everything that he does because he loves you enough that he gave his everything for you. That's my king. Amen. That's my king. I'm going to tell you this morning, David is showing us the example. God is giving us the example through David, the man after God's own heart, the man who had been anointed by God's man to go to him and to tell him and to anoint him from on high with the oil. And he was anointed and he was here and he was king. And just because he was anointed and he was a man after God's own heart and that he was destined to be king, and God put him in a place and he made sure that he was after his own heart and he stayed after him, he made mistakes. How can God's man make a mistake? It's pretty easy, isn't it? Pretty easy. We lose focus every now and again. We lose sight of things every now and again. Even David says here in verse number 6, he said, "I am weary with my groaning all the night." Well, let's just stop there. He said, "I'm weary with my groaning." He said, "God, I'm tired of hearing myself complain. I'm weary. I'm tired of me complaining." Do you ever get tired of yourself complaining? Think about that for a minute. Do you ever get tired of hearing yourself complain? And I guarantee you, if you ever get to the point to where you're tired of hearing yourself complain, it's kind of like Daddy used to tell me. He said, "If you think you're tired of it," he said, "I've been tired of it for a week." But what does our God do? Because he's our King and because he loves us, he listens. If we're tired of complaining, let's do something about it. I don't care who you are this in here this morning. If we're tired of it, let's do something about it. You know who can do something about it? Raise your hand. You're the only one that can do anything about your griping and your complaining, your faults, your failures. "Well, God's supposed to take them away from me." It doesn't miraculously go away. You've got to have a desire to want to serve. You got to have a desire to want to do. David has a desire here. He is praying for forgiveness. He said, "I'm even tired of hearing myself." And he says, and then he goes on, he says, "All night I make my bed to swim." He said, "I have been so distraught that I'm just getting swimmy headed." He says, "I have watered my couch with tears." When's the last time we watered anything with our tears? "Oh, I've had a service and God touched me enough. I had one little tear, one little drop." When's the last time we were heartbroken enough that we sobbed in God's presence? Sobbed because of the things that we've done. Sobbed because we're tired of hearing ourselves complain. We're going to get to a better side of this here in just a minute, folks, I promise. Nobody likes to hear this side of it. "Well, preacher, you know, it ain't right for us to do those things." According to what we've just read, it is scriptural for us to do those things. When God is in our midst and when God is working and when we realize that we're wrong, it is for us to go to the throne of grace with tears, with heartbrokenness, and repent of the things that hinder us from serving. He says in verse number 8, he asked God, he says, well, let me go back to verse number 7. He says, "My eye is consumed because of grief. It waxeth old because of all of mine enemies. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity, for the Lord hath heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord had heard my supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. Let all of my enemies be ashamed and sore vexed, and let them return and be ashamed suddenly." He said, "God, I know you're listening. I know you hear me. And God, I need you to put them away. I need you to put my blinders on so I'll quit looking at what they're doing and let me focus on you. Because what they're doing doesn't matter." What happened through David's entire life when the bear showed up to get his sheep, he killed the bear. When the lion showed up to get his sheep, he killed the lion. What happened when Goliath showed up? He said, y'all going to let him talk to us that away? I don't think so. And when Goliath looked at him and said, you coming at me with rocks? Do you think I'm a dog? He said, no, I come to you in the name of the Lord. And he took his head. Hallelujah, that's my king. And as he is praying, he said, I want you to know that God has heard my prayer. He has heard my supplication. He will receive my prayer. He said, let all of my enemies be ashamed and sore. He said, don't let me focus upon what my enemy's doing. Let me see what you're doing for me, oh God. When we look in this world, we don't see that the world's doing anything for us, right? The world is not doing anything for a body of believers. It's not doing anything for the Christian because it does not want to believe in a Christian body. They want to believe that there is nothing left out here. They want to think that there is no God. They don't want to think that there's no hell. They don't want to think that there's life after death. You just go into the ground and it's over. I would hate to live my life with absolutely no hope in anything better than this right here. I wouldn't want to do that. David didn't want to do that. He knew there was something better. How did he know there was something better? Because God had revealed it to him. He had given him hope. How do you know that, preacher? Have you ever read the 23rd Psalm? The same David that was repenting of his sin, crying out to God, that wept until his couch was wet, is the same David that said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's my king. He can take a man from repentance to deliverance. He can take a man from being filthy in the old miry clay until he is whiter than snow. He can take a man that is down, that is downtrodden, that is feels defeated, and he can bring him up and make him feel like he's the only person on the earth. That's my God. That's my King. That's my Savior. He is my shepherd. I don't have to want for anything else because he's my all in all. What does he ask from me? He asked me to give him me. That's all I have to give is who I am. Have you given yourself to him? He maketh me to lie down in green pastures when you're tired and when you're weary. He says, here, I've brought you to a nice place. It's safe for you. Sit down. Have a meal. Rest just a little while. Don't nobody on this earth do that for you, do they? Hadn't been that long ago, Lisa and I were talking. She said, boy, when you're a teacher, you work as long as you're not dead, and then they might ask you to come in a half a day. We live in a world that requires so much from us. You know what God requires from us? Love me. Serve me. Be my hands and my feet. That's not much, considering everybody else says, get it done, get it done. You need to do this and this and this and this and this and give you a list of things. God doesn't give us a list. He says, love me. Love each other. He'll let us sit down when we need to sit down. He said he'll lead us beside the still waters. We need refreshing. He'll give us the refreshment. Why do you think we come to church on Sunday morning? It is to get refreshed, renewed, strengthened to go out and to fight in this whole ugly world. Every day it is a spiritual battle. It is not a battle of flesh and blood. We talked about that this morning during our Bible study. It is not against flesh and blood. It is against Satan himself. Satan has blinded so many people. Satan has blinded the leaders of around this world to anything God-like that they don't know where to turn. But folks, we know where to turn, and we need to turn to our King, and we need to make sure that everybody knows that's my King, because He is the King of Kings, and He is the Lord of Lords. He is the one who loves us enough that He restoreth our soul. He leadeth us in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. It's not for our sake, it's for His sake. He does it because He loves us. But it's for His name's sake. Why do we live this life? Why do I stand here and preach? It's not for Kenny King's glory. It is for God's glory. It is so that you know the truth and you hear the truth. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. We don't have to fear Satan, because Satan doesn't have the victory. He doesn't have control. He doesn't have anything if we don't allow him to have it. We can look at him, we can look to him, and we can say, get behind me, Satan, and he has to flee from us, because the presence of God is within us. We have that power. We have that right. We have my King. I hope he's your King today. We don't have to fear any evil. It says, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. Whew. Boy, that rod was a weapon. Up to about 60, 70 feet, I believe it was, that rod was a deadly weapon in the hands of a shepherd. They could pin a wolf or a coyote to the ground, 50 to 60 feet. That shepherd's hook, that shepherd's crook, if the lamb had went over the side of the cliff and he couldn't get back, reach right under him, pull him up, pull him to safety, pull her to safety. Oh, that should be a comfort, folks, that when we're in danger, he is the authority. Just like he allowed David to be. When we're lost, that shepherd's hook comes out and he'll guide us back to the path that we need to be on with him. He says, thou preparest a table before me in the presence. Folks, we can sit and eat heartily in the presence of our enemy. You know why we can do that? Because our God has it all under control. It does not catch him by surprise what Satan does. It doesn't catch him off guard. It catches us off guard. We look at things and we say, oh my goodness, here's something else. What's this world coming to? Has anybody ever said that? We have all said that. It's not a surprise to him. He actually has told us that it's going to get worse than this. The worst is yet to come in this walk of life. But let me tell you, if you're a child of his, the best is yet to come for you, because we're going to leave this world and we're going to be with him. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Isn't that a wonderful promise? He told the thief on the cross, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. That's what he told the thief on the cross. They didn't allow that thief to get down from the cross. They didn't allow Jesus to come down from the cross and go down to the river and be baptized, or for Jesus to baptize him. They left him hanging on that cross. It's not the baptism that saves you. It's not your good works that saves you. It's not your membership on a church roll that saves you. It is not your attitude in which you do things that saves you. It is a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And folks, this is where I'm coming from today. With the world in the shape that it's in, I want you to know, because I love each and every one of you, and for those that may be listening and watching online, I want you to understand, because this is very, very important. Your status in the church or in the community does not matter. The confession and the belief that's in your heart, that matters. The thief on the cross, when he confessed, all he looked done was looked at the Lord and said, "Father, remember me. Jesus, remember me when you enter into your kingdom." All we've got to do today is confess and believe that he is there and that he can save you from your sins, that he will be your salvation, and he will come into your heart. Why is my King so important to me? He gave me a new life. He gave me a new outlook. And he has given me and shown me grace when I have stumbled and fall. He has given me a family to worship with, that whom I love very dearly, that is willing to help in a time of need, who is willing to pick us up when we stumble, not be judgmental over all the little stuff. That's my King in action in the people around me. And I'm thankful that we have that today. The altar is open for anybody who would like to come and to talk to the Lord, to give him praise, just to talk to him and maybe say, "God, I'm tired of hearing myself whine." But in our Moravian hymnal, we're going to sing hymn number 169, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee." And I'm going to ask you this morning, I'm going to ask you and just tell you, the altar is open for whatever you need. Nobody will judge you. It's not about that. It's about making sure things are right, ready, giving him praise and glory. Hymn number 169, let's stand together and sing, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee."
Thank you.
Father, thank you for being faithful, merciful to me, a sinner. God, forgive me where I fail you and strengthen me in your word. Strengthen all of us in your word and in your deeds. May our enemies be vexed sore this week as we go out. And may we share that you are our King, Master, Ruler. You are our all in all as we go out this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, give you the mic. Yes, sorry.